Greetings from Brazil. My name is Tony Toller and I'm with my friend Bob sailing his brand new leopard catamaran from Cape Town in South Africa to Barbados in the Caribbean, 5,500 miles. We've been at sea 27 days and it's been a long, harrowing journey. Some parts have gone well, but we also had storms and problems to contend with. But hey, we're alive and well, we've reached land safely. We have no shortage of meat or anything like that. We are absolutely stocked to the eyeballs. We had planned for the whole journey non-stop, so we have plenty of provisions, like 30 tins of baked beans and so on and so forth. Well, lots to show you. Some fantastic dolphin shots, which are really, really cool. Like, it was so exciting watching them. And let's get on and share it with you. Considering the number of power-hungry items on the Leopard, the electrical system coped well. Two solar panels that came with the boat were supplemented by three large panels Bob ordered locally that provided an extra 1.1 kilowatts of power. In addition to the kettle, which was boiled several times a day, there are many things on permanently, such as the fridge freezer, autopilot, and navigation equipment. Then there are the occasional loads, such as the water maker, water pumps, microwave, toaster, navigation lights, and dinghy davit. However, to lower or raise the anchor, it was essential to run the portside engine. There are big drives around the world to cut the use of plastic, but a trip like this makes you realise how much we still dispose of. We are very careful to segregate degradable waste from plastic, which we bag up and plan to take ashore, but I was staggered how the plastic far exceeded the paper, eggshells, tea bags and other stuff we felt we could safely throw overboard. Navigation on this trip was pretty straightforward. As the crow flies, Cape Town to Barbados is almost a straight line, so apart from our deviation into Cabedelo, we steered northwest around 320 degrees the whole way. The problem is that the wind doesn't always make that course easy, so we had several deviations where we would perhaps sail north for a few hours and then west for a while, as this screen shows. With these instruments, course plotting couldn't be easier. On the left is the wind gauge, showing the exact wind direction and speed. It also shows the speed of the boat through the water. In the centre is the chart plotter with a graphical illustration of the boat and our course. This also shows our speed over ground. On the right is the autopilot, showing the course being steered. This can be quickly adjusted by 1 or 10 degree steps at the click of a button. The important part is to know where you are at any one time. A lightning strike could wipe out the entire navigation system. So at noon and midnight, we would take readings and complete the ship's log. I found it best to photograph the instruments so that any discrepancies discovered later could be checked. These numbers were transposed into the log, then our position was logged on the chart. I found it easiest to mark our latitude on the left and our longitude at the top, then use the parallel rules to mark our exact location. I would then use the dividers to check that the distance travelled since the last reading tallied with that recorded on the chart plotter. Finally, I draw a little triangle and note the date and time. We've been eating pretty well on our passage, though after about 2 weeks, the only surviving vegetables were onions, potatoes and cabbage. In the engine room 1 minute, cooking the next.
Engine room and cooking room.
Bob likes to cook, and during lockdown in Cape Town we had some grand meals. Here's the selection.
That looks fun.
Come on, Jeanette.
Where's the gravy?
You do your sauce. No
worries. How do I turn the oven off?
I'll do that. You.
How is my
lord?
You just have one better.
What are you doing on your hands and knees, Bob?
You're 65 short. Yeah, you're going to go up to 69, yeah?
Pretty good.
Eh?
Pretty good.
How
much is this one? I thought she was 59.
I thought she was 49.
Compliments will get you everywhere.
I don't know what is hot.
Fantastic. Steaks are roaring away here. The chef's out enjoying a cigarette. What are you doing? Are you being helpful? The kitchen is in chaos. The dining table's set, which is nice. All our colourful cushions. We're having a St George's Day rehearsal. Bob's made chicken curry from yesterday's roast chicken. And we have some rice. Bon appetit. And we're watching The Vicar of Dibley. Does the Pride of Bucks have a Michelin star yet?
I think not. No.
What Toad in the Hole is. We have cabbage, vegetables, and roast potatoes, and roast beef. Very good. Despite the alcohol ban, we seem to get by. Our good friends Ulrika and Chum helped in that respect. And one night, we even ended up dancing. Don't be shy. Whilst on the subject of eating, they say you learn something new every day, and one of the joys I learnt was baking a loaf of bread. It's so easy. I'm going to upload full instructions in a separate video, but just to give you the gist, you need white or brown flour, yeast, sugar, salt, water, and olive oil. You mix these all up, which takes a couple of minutes, then add the water until you have a workable dough. For about 5 minutes, you knock this about, then leave it to rise for an hour, then you knock it about again and leave for another hour. Finally, pop in the oven for about 35 minutes and there's a wonderful homemade loaf. If you want to see the full instructions, look for Bread Making on Board a Yacht or subscribe to me on YouTube and you'll be notified when it gets posted. Catching fish can be quite exciting. In this instance, I pulled the line in to check the lure, and just as I was about to lift it out of the water, a fish jumped out and grabbed it. I quickly passed the line to Bob and fetched the camera. That's running straight over a rocky ledge or tree that fell, a new shiny boat that I can tow to. Then comes the not so nice part of gutting and filleting. So when the weekend comes and work gets done, I got one thing on my... I've only ever watched other people doing this, but hey ho, there's a first time for everything. It takes my stress away. I wanna go fishing. Despite a very sharp knife, it's actually quite hard work. The fish is built strongly and the bone is tough to get through. Once the head and tail were removed, the rest was fairly straightforward. I thought I would have a go at skinning one section, but soon gave up. Much easier after cooking. I don't ever want to stop. It's what I love, it's number one on my list of things to do. I want to go fishing, that's what I want to do. Yeah, I want to go fishing, that's what I want to do. There we go, job done. Incidentally, we had a number of flying fish landing on the boat during the nights. They must jump really high to reach the side decks. The highlight of our trip had to be a dolphin sighting. A pod is usually around 12 of these beautiful sea mammals, but in this case we reckon there were at least double that number. They stayed and played with our twin bow waves for a good 20 minutes and were a joy to watch and film. What particularly excited me was seeing the youngsters swimming with their parents. If you look carefully, there are quite a few. Again, I'm including a short extract here. I'll upload a longer video in due course. In Chapter 9, we visit Devil's Island, made notorious by Steve McQueen and Dustin Hoffman in the film Papillon. Bob gives praise to Neptune as we cross the equator, and we finally reach Barbados. Join us soon.